Why is it so dark? In the beginning, it is always dark. What is that? One grain of sand. It is all that remains of my vast empire. Fantasia has totally disappeared. Yes. Everything's been in vain. No, it hasn't. Fantasia can arise in you. From your dreams and wishes, Bastion. How? Open your hand. What are you going to wish for? I don't know. Then there will be no Fantasia anymore. How many wishes do I get? As many as you want. And the more wishes you make, the more magnificent Fantasia will become.
Really?
Try it. Then my first wish is...
Thank you.
Hey everyone, and welcome to the Chrono Show. You can call me Andrews if you want to, but wow, this is, I'm excited and feeling the goosebumps here. I get the opportunity to have an amazing podcast today. I want to introduce co-hosting is NGG, Nintendo Gamer Girl. What's going on?
Nothing much. How's everybody?
Doing good.
All right, and DJC Game Studios.
What's happening? Good to see everyone.
And our special guest, Tammy Stronach. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Hey, I'm glad to have you here. So we got some great questions for you throughout the time so we can talk about the Neverending Story and Man in Witch Films. So let's get started. Let's get to this right away. And I'm going to go with my first question. Let's see. I'm going to put it right here. Can you tell us how it all started from how acting began leading up to the Neverending Story?
Sure. So I was sort of a ham as a little kid. I think we all know those kids that just need to perform. So I would always come down to the kitchen and put on one Swan Lake or another for my parents. And they, put me in theater class. I just happened to be in an acting class when the casting director for The Neverending Story was in town, and she happened to be friends with my acting teacher, and they organized a lunch date in between all the castings. So she came by to my theater class, and she came a little bit early, and she's the tail end of the class and saw me do a little scene in the class and was like, do you want to come audition for this film? And I was 10. And I was like, absolutely. Yeah, I'm playing Piglet and Winnie the Pooh right now. And I just did Oliver and I just love performing. And sure, I'll audition for your film. I didn't know what I was doing at all. And I told my parents and they're like, yeah, sure. Go for whatever audition that is. So it was really an accident. Happy one.
Definitely a good experience. How it all began. Let's see, my next question here. I want to make sure to get this out of the way and get the next one here. How did you prepare for your role in the Neverending Story? We see an emotional role, having been scared that nothing was coming.
I was a very serious girl, and I took the role very, very seriously. So, of course, I read Michael Ende's book and had conversations about with my mother, primarily about the difference between the script and the book. And I was in love with the world and the sort of the whole story. I just had a little notebook and I would think about my character and I would jot down adjectives that described her. I also just listened to the director. I mean, I think so much of, it's so special when you have a really good director who can kind of plug you into a part. And like, it was crazy. I mean, the set was amazing. The costume was amazing. I had so much help from the things around me because the world, I didn't have to imagine it. It was literally built, It was like, it actually existed, So it was a really incredible situation, actually.
Thank you so much for that. What does a Neverending Story mean to you?
To me, the Neverending Story is kind of about how young people have to imagine a better world than the big old mess that adults leave for them. It sort of repeats in history, right? Like you kind of are a kid and you're like, why is the world so messed up? And then you become an adult and you're like exhausted and you're trying to get your taxes in on time and the house and you're like, I can't listen to the news. My head hurts and I can't do anything about it anyway. And you kind of lose the ability to kind of activate that kid in you that wants this world to be a good place for everybody. And the problem is when we didn't let that thing in us die, of course, the opportunities for change die with it. So to me, it's like a really political story. It's about like daring to dream for a better world and daring the young people of the world to be courageous enough to, you know, tell us old people to just, you've had your chance, we're going to do a better job. That's what I think it's about.
We all got to keep that kid inside of us, though, you know?
Yeah. Right, it's about keeping the kid inside you alive. That's what it's about. And so, but it's also just sweet. It's like laugh, cry, feel, have fun, play. Like, just don't
goof off. Just make people laugh. Off. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, be with your friends. Like, don't ossify and become this grumpy robot that so much of adulthood is asking us.
Exactly. To it's like,
you know, it's really hard to keep the kid inside alive. It's just, it's a hard job.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. Can you remember your time on set with Barrett Oliver, Bastion, and Noah Hathaway at Atreyu? Did you guys have time to goof off and get to know each other?
Yes, we did. We had a lot of time. We had a whole summer. And they were wonderful. They were super cute. They were so different. Barrett was really into his G.I. Joe figures and very sweet, a little bit shy. Noah was like very physical, like he would enter the room with like a backflip or something.
Wow. Awesome.
And just always running and moving. We had like a pool in the hotel where we were all staying in Munich. So we would hang out in the pool, and then super crazy. I guess in America, people don't do this, but we were in Germany. So we would always go to the beer gardens with all the crew, and they let kids in the beer gardens in Germany. So because everyone just hangs out outside and drinks beer. So we were always hanging out with the crew at the beer gardens. And of course, like, I couldn't drink. So I learned to do all these like tricks with like coasters, and like, I have all these like weird like bar tricks with coasters from being
at cool.
months and months as a kid and just being bored out of my mind. But so, you know, yeah, we hung out. It was great.
Thank you. Next question I have is for my guy, Ryan Drayson. He cannot show up today. So what can you tell us about your careers in theater and dancing, your passion for dance?
I have always loved theater and dance just from the moment I could walk. And, you know, it's interesting. I think that for me, I don't really care if a project is big or small. I just care if it's good. And so I just really wanted to spend my life in the theater. There's something about being with a group of people and making something happen together as a team. We're doing it right now, right? Like there's this feeling where you bring something to life as a team that for me is like, is the best feeling. And so I just loved it, whether it was dancing or whether it was acting, whether it was for, you know, 60 people in a little theater, or whether it was a big tour in Europe. Like, I just really like that feeling. So I was just always chasing it.
And that would be my final question for me. And I got the next set of questions from NGG. Let me get this one out of the way. All right. If you want to go ahead.
Okay. So my question to you is, when you were filming the movie, did you know that this was going to be a very popular movie, or did you have no idea?
I had no idea. And actually at the premiere, I went to go see it, and I was kind of devastated initially because it was in German, because they dubbed the whole film in German. And I thought nobody would ever see me doing it in English. I was like, oh, it's just going to be in German.
Oh, oh no.
Oh, wow.
I was like, well, I guess a few German people will see it. Hey, no. No, I don't think anybody could have known. And that's what's kind of cool about it, right? I mean, I think it was really like fans that made it popular over time, you know?
Yeah.
Right.
See,
the next question I have is, so I, as a child, used to watch The NeverEnding Story three times a day. was that something you rewatched, or because you weren't on the movie, was the magic of the movie kind of gone for you?
I did not watch it three times a day. That would be weird.
Like, I didn't watch it again after lunch.
There were movies that, like, I fell in love with that way. For me, Princess Bride, with that film, it was like the perfect film.
Yeah.
And I was obsessed with it. I just thought it was so witty. So I know that thing. And it's you know, there are films where the more times you watch them, you see new things in them each time, or you laugh even more at the joke that you're expecting. So it's really fun to do that.
Okay.
All right. So another question I had was, did your classmates ever watch the movie? And if so, did they ask you questions about it? And what were your responses to the questions at the time?
So at the time, my classmates really didn't know about it. When it was released in the States, initially it didn't have a big impact. I don't know if you guys it became popular over time. So I guess my classmates knew that I was in it, but it wasn't a big deal. And then kind of towards high school, it started to become more like a bigger deal. Hmm. And then honestly, right. I was just so weird. I was like, I don't want to talk about that. Because I just want to, you know, when you're in high school, you want to fit in. You just want to be like everybody else. You want to be different. Well, maybe some people want to be different, but I just was like, I just wanted to be one of the gang. So basically, you know, I was like, oh, don't ask her. She doesn't like to talk about that. So I never talked to anybody about it.
Oh, wow.
And then I came to New York and I became a dancer. And I didn't even put it on my resume because dancers don't care if you're in the, like, they're like, they want to know if you can dance. They don't know if you can sit, you know? So, and so it wasn't even on my resume. And then I had like this whole dance career. Nobody knew.
Oh, wow.
That's and cool, then, though.
It's crazy, right?
Yeah.
And then somebody contacted me about a Comic-Con, and I was like, what is that?
Okay, yeah, right?
And they were like, Noah's going to be there. And I was like, oh, that would be so fun to see Noah. I haven't seen him in so long. And I went to the Comic-Con, and I was amazed by how many people still cared about the Neverending Story. I couldn't believe it. And it was moving, and people were like, it inspired me to be the first person in my family to go to college, and inspired me to become a chef, or, you know, like, I don't know, they had all these stories about what the story meant to them, or that they were bullied and it gave them courage to face it. And I was like, that's so crazy that I've been hiding from this thing my whole life that is actually really special to be a part of. And maybe I should stop hiding.
Yeah. We're hiding.
That's where I am. Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
That's your final question, NGG.
So I guess, my last question about the Neverending Story was, acting something you wanted, or was it something your parents wanted for you in the very beginning?
Acting was something I wanted, definitely. My parents were archaeologists.
Oh, wow.
And they were just very academic, and they were mostly interested in the sort of ancient civilizations thousands and thousands of years ago. Like, whatever's happening now was completely irrelevant, you know, but what was happening for the Zoroastrians at the fire temple was the thing. They were completely, you know, incredibly wonderful, smart, dynamic people, but like, my world, like acting and dancing, was not their world. So it was really me. And I think that's actually one of the reasons I didn't continue in film, is it was so overwhelming for my parents. They were like, how are we supposed to navigate our child through Hollywood, you know, when we have to actually think about, you know, Cyrus the Great, and I have to finish this paper, you know, like, it was like, there was no way they could even understand the pitfalls of Hollywood. You know, as a kid, I think there's kids that make it through Hollywood really well. And, you know, Sarah Connelly's an example of like a young actress who's just done a brilliant job, or Natalie Portman. But there's equally so many stories of people who didn't have the right protections around them and kind of were turned into meat. exploited and ended up feeling really burned. And I think they just were so nervous that that would happen. So I redirected my focus into dance, which was a kind of smaller scale thing. And I loved it. I loved it equally to theater. So, and then I just kind of got sucked into the dance world. The dancing is, I mean, everybody knows that dancing's fun, right? You go to a party.
Yeah.
That's my job. I dance. Why didn't you?
I dance as a career.
Dancing. Like, I don't know.
Dancing.
But like, I was having so much fun. But then I kept on creeping into plays in New York. And then I ended up in a theater company for 7 years. So acting just kept on, like, I just kept on doing plays and getting pulled into plays. And then I was secretly harboring a wish to do film again. But I was sort of like, oh, that's impossible. That's crazy. Like, I'll just keep doing what I'm doing.
Right.
I wanted to slip in something real quick, mentioning your parents were archaeologists. Is that where you followed into a little bit of footsteps being a professor as well?
Definitely. My father was a professor, and I think, you know, it's so much easier in a way sometimes to kind of do the thing you've seen and you know. So I was a professional dancer for 20 years. I ran my own company in New York and we toured everywhere. But then eventually I wanted to have a baby and this thing called health insurance. I don't know if you've heard of it. So I don't know. I just was like, maybe now, at, you know, almost 40 while I'm pregnant, I should get that. So I got a full-time job as a professor and it was fabulous. I really loved it. I ended up teaching for 10 years in at Marymount Manhattan College, and I taught choreography primarily and improvisation. But yeah, that's definitely sort of my roots. And so I felt very comfortable doing that.
Nice. Well, thank you so much for that. DJ C.
Oh man. And by the way, Nintendo Gamer Girl, like there was movies I watched like back to back every day too, like Back to the Future and Ghostbusters. So I would just, I understand that. I do understand that. But anyways, yeah. So I have a fun one. Did you ever get to sit on Falcor, which is the flying dog, during the downtime or any time during the filming of the movie?
No, and I'm still upset about it.
Oh man! I'm surprised you guys didn't sneak up like after the crew's starting to clean. You just kind of sneak over there, and
this was like guarded. This was such a huge production. There were so many people. You know, you had like three people ushering you into every corner. But it's interesting. I'm going to the Bavarian Studios in May. They invited me. There's a documentary about the Neverending Story being made. It's called Life After Atreyu.
Ooh.
And they asked me if I would come for a private tour of the Bavarian Studios to do some filming for it. And, you know, why not? So I am going to ask.
Do it.
Yes.
Get a picture.
This is your time. Your time to ride Falcor. That's so great. I really hope you do. That's so great. This is a good one I wanted to know. So during the dramatic scene, I want to know, were you actually crying during the final scenes? And are you able to kind of muster up and cry when you act?
Yes, I was definitely crying in the final scenes.
Wow.
I mean, acting is really hard and there's so much more to it than crying. I mean, I basically could cry pretty much at the drop of a hat. I get sad really easily. Really too.
Well, right, yeah. Well, you seem very happy, so
it's just there.
Well, that's cool though. I mean, but it's like so, like just to see that it was a great performance, you know. And I know you were a very young lady. You were what, 11 when you made that?
Yeah.
But that was just like it was such an emotional part of that movie, and it made it so such a solid scene. It was that's just amazing. That's cool.
I mean, I know that. The reason that I loved acting as a kid, because you asked me if it was my parents or me, and it was definitely me, is the only place I didn't feel like a total weirdo was when I was acting. Because in life, I would like see, you know, little roadkill, and it'd be like 2 hours of crying in the car. Oh. My sister were like, oh, geez, you just stop, you know. And then this happened. I was like, oh, it started again, you know. Like, and so in life, it was like I was constantly trying to like not be emotional and just like, okay, I got to like hold it together like these other people around me and, you know, not be me. And then like you got into like like a show, and it was like, oh, you can feel things like just really easily. And I was like, I can. And they're like, well, that's good. And I'm like, it is.
Like, that's a really good thing.
So, you know, I think for me, it was just like home. It was like the way that I'm built finally wasn't a problem. It was actually good.
So it ended up being a good trait to have, like, for that industry at that time, you know?
Yeah, like, I'm sure, like, if I wanted to be an emergency medical doctor, not a good trait.
No, you'd be like, oh, my God, I got news for you.
It's my emergency! The doctor's crying. We're right. Going to need to
take the most. Oh, my God, what's the news? Who's dead is crying.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Let's see. Next question. There you go.
Oh, yeah. Do you still keep in touch with anyone from the original movie cast?
So, as I said, I see Noah now, and it's been really nice. I tend to do the Comic-Cons when he's going because I know he's going to be cool. There. So we tend to sit together, and it really is so lovely to be together after all these years. And he's really gracious when he meets people. He's very giving, and I think it makes people excited to see the two of us together. It's like,
oh, yeah.
So that's been really nice. It's kind of been a couple years now where we meet up every couple of months at a Comic-Con event.
Nice.
That's so great. There's so many of those nowadays too. You know, it's like, we got one here in Detroit called, I think it's Motor City Comic-Con. That's kind of on the suburbs of Detroit. And it just becomes bigger and bigger and bigger each year. And it's like, oh my God, like these things are huge events. And they're very cool to see so many things from games to movies to everything. It's just amazing.
Totally.
And okay, the fourth one was, what was your audition process like when, and how did you get this? But you kind of did say where, how you kind of got the part, but I like when you went in to do your audition, like how, what was that like?
Well, so I came from a show that morning, with pig face makeup on. Cause I played Piglet. So I had like bright pink, grease paint and like big, like black, like nostrils. Like I was Piglet. So I like came in and everyone looks really kind of polished and, you know, they all have agents and they're looking very like they know what they're doing. And I was like, I should take this off. So I'm like in the bathroom, like trying to scrub my makeup off. And it's just like smearing.
Oh, my God.
Oh no. Yeah. So anyway, I get most of it off as much as I can. And I go in and I do the audition and I loved the part. I loved it. I was just like so into it. I loved the lines. I was like, I really loved it. And then I get a call from the woman who was the casting agent that asked me to come. And she's like, listen, do you think you could come in for another audition and like not be in pig face makeup? Like, I'm going to recommend you get a dress. I don't know if you have one of those. And I was like, I will get a dress. And I will, you know. And so then she was really sweet. She was really rooting for me. And she, like, met me in the bathroom and, like, did my makeup. And I feel like she was really rooting for me. So
yeah.
That was the second audition. And then I had to fly to Germany for a third audition. So I had three. And the last one was really harrowing because you're so close and you know it's either you or one other person.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you just don't know which way it's going to go. So that one was really like a nail biter.
Oh, yeah. Especially after going over to another country and then doing that. Oh, man. That's it. I think it would have been so funny if, like, you like, I walked in, everyone's polished. I got the pig face on. And they're like, no, she's the one. We're taking her. Yeah. She got the character. She got everything. She's got pizzazz.
Yeah, they were like, "Can you see her not like that?"
Yeah, but not like that for the movie.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. There you go. Next question, DJC.
Oh, okay. Yeah, this is one I wanted to know is I heard that they had contacted you when they were doing, I believe, the sequel, Neverending Story 2, and you turned it down. You did not want to do that, correct? And why was that, if that is correct?
I would say that, you know, my parents and I had a conversation after the Neverending Story sort of did get a little bit more popular, and there were some additional movie offers. And they were just very straight with me. And they were like, you know, we just don't feel like we can safely navigate you through this. And if you want to do it yourself when you're an adult, then we'll, you know, support you in whatever you want to do. But, you know, as long as we're in charge, we're not going to capsize this boat on our watch.
Yeah, no, that makes sense.
So we're going to turn this down. What they didn't tell me is like how much money was getting turned down. And when I was a starving dancer in New York, like a hard-boiled egg and a bagel a day, I was like, you know what, maybe we could have done the sequel.
Just could have made some money in the dance career, maybe.
Yeah. Like, you know, whatever, live and learn.
Would have helped. No, that's interesting, though. That really is, yeah. No, but that's understandable. Oh, okay, I got another one here. So... Do you believe in, like, you know how they're rebooting everything or more or less, like, sometimes they'll do a continuation? Do you think, like, a reboot or a remake of Neverending Story would be, like, a good idea these days? Like, do you think that would be something?
Like, feel when I answer this, like, I immediately, like, divide. You know, it's like the people that...
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely.
And then, like, I end up in one camp, and then all mm-hmm. those people are going to be against me. So I'm going to wade in to this... dangerous water you have stirred up in front of me. Right.
Oh no.
Just don't sink in the swamp when you're in the water. That would be
I'm gonna be honest, I like reboots. I said yeah. it. Because they don't replace the original. No. Right? Yeah. Like mm-hmm. I'm still gonna watch the original Blade Runner. I'm never gonna stop. Yeah. It's so good. But that doesn't mean that I can't enjoy and be curious about like what the new Blade Runner was, you know? Yeah. And to me, it's like, as an artist, I believe in creating things. I believe that every person, if they can, it's such a privilege and such a spiritually fulfilling thing to just make stuff. Like the video you made
create,
today.
Just to create, yeah.
You know, just making stuff is so... cathartic, and this act of like bringing something into the world, this act of bringing yourself in a literal way into the world is so it's exciting. And as a teacher, that was my mission, is to get my students to make things and be creative. And I've made things my whole life. So like the idea of saying like, no, you can't reboot it. Like it just doesn't, it doesn't work for me, because I feel like, isn't the mission of like the Neverending Story to like use your imagination and reimagine Fantasia, right? Like every person's supposed to like bring themselves and imagine. And I don't know, there's not like three geniuses and we're just going to let them be the ones that are the, you know, the get to make
Very
it.
Very true. Yeah.
So I'm a reboot person. I heard they're rebooting Labyrinth. Did you guys hear that?
Oh, wow. No, yeah, I was just talking about that today.
I love Labyrinth. And we used the Jim Henson Creature Shop puppet.
I was just going to bring that up. That's so awesome.
We're doing that puppet. Like, yeah. I'm losing my mind. Like, I'm so excited for this reboot. So I'm sorry, people who don't like reboots. I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, that's great. Great answer.
All right, you know what? We got something big coming up, and I'm very excited for this, because how long has it been since the Neverending Story up to your new film you got coming up, which is Man and Witch?
I'm not even going to answer that. A very, long time.
Okay, very long time, but yes, I prepared a nice short clip for you guys, stuff I collected, and hope you guys enjoy it. It's about 2 minutes, so we can enjoy that for the Man and Witch questions. So let's get down to the right clip. Oh, I was about to click on this one. Here we go.
All right.
Oh, I still get goosebumps with that one.
That was a cool screenshot. So cool. I cannot wait.
Thank you. I edited earlier a few days ago, and I had to finish, add some more stuff today. So I just did it within moments before I got connected with you guys. So I'm glad to add. I keep seeing there's always something new, a new photo added to the Man in Witch Twitter or something. Oh, I got to get this.
Slowly trickling out. Slowly.
It's coming out. So the video's going to get longer in time. Yeah. So let's see. Let me get to the questions here. So we're going to start off with myself. The first question that I'm going to go on with NGG and then DJ Studio. So it's one after the other. So let's get into our questions. And why did you make the film Man in Witch?
So as I said, you know, I started going to these Comic-Con conventions and meeting people who kept asking me, so when are you going to make another film? You know, it's been a while. Like, what's happening? When are you going to do it? And I was like, oh, no, no. I'm a dancer now. I'm a professor now. Like, no, no, no. But then they kept asking. And I kind of was like, you know, signing a lot of autographs over the Empress's face. And many people would request the quote, do what you dream. And I kept on writing, like, do what you dream, like, over and over and over again. And I was like, kind of is a dream to, like, get back into acting. But also, you know, on my own terms and not just as an actress, but as an executive producer. And I was like, I just feel like I can't keep signing these papers and, like, these autographs in good conscience and not dare myself to, like, live it. And like, maybe I need to take the Empress's advice, right? She's not me, she's a character. Like, maybe I need to listen to her. And so I literally just decided to take her advice. And I knew I was scared. And then whenever I'm scared, I know that's really good because it means that I'm, like, you know, touching something that I'm gonna grow and I really wanna do it. Because you don't do it if you're not scared, it doesn't matter.
Right, enough, you gotta have that. Yeah.
So that's why I did it.
Nice. Oh, thanks so much. Nice. And NGG got you the next one.
So who is this movie for? Like, what should the audience, who this movie cater to?
So we made this film for 80s fantasy kids from the 80s who loved fantasy films, who are now adults and who have kids. You know, basically growing up, there were all these 80s fantasy movies that you guys all mentioned, like Back to the Future and Goonies and Dark Crystal and Neverending Story. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I'm nostalgic for those films. And I feel like when I was at these Comic Cons, people would tell me that they miss those kinds of movies, movies that aren't made like with an algorithm or, you know, that also there's like real things, like real locations and real puppets. And the star of the show isn't the CGI, but it's the story and the character transformation and the underdog and, you know, like the little guy winning. And I miss those stories too. So we made it for families. We made it for like Gen X fantasy film buffs who want to go on a date. And they look for their babysitter and they can bring their kids and the kids will get something out of it and the parents will get something out of it and everyone will go home happy.
Nice.
That's so cool.
Thank you so much for that. See, and DJC,
have you done any internal screenings of this, and what are people saying about it if you have done this?
We've done a few internal screenings. I'd like to do a few more. And the biggest thing that people say is people don't make films like this anymore. And I think that it's true. There's a way in which all of the sort of incredible technology that we have, I actually really love amazing CGI and amazing special effects. I'm not saying that to detract from it, but I think that sometimes it ends up replacing the kind of bones of the story.
And, I agree. Yeah.
And so we just wanted to, like, people have been saying that they just are enjoying a film that is putting story front and center, and like everything's just in service of the story. And that it's charming, and that it makes you laugh, and then it makes you tear up. And as you know, I like to laugh and then tear up, so that makes me happy. And that, you know, they enjoy seeing something where the characters, the love wins in the story, but it's not just for the young or the perfect or the heroes. It's for flawed people. And and that there's a kind of charm to the film. It's like not slick, but it makes you feel things. It's kind of got that, like, a little bit of a more like lo-fi, but like super charming feeling to it.
That's wonderful. And then working, like you said, was Jim Henson's Creature Shop, and like that right there just puts so much art. Like you said, growing up to stuff like the Dark Crystal and the things they can do with special effects, but using something physically that you're literally acting with physically, and not like a ball on a stick or, you know, something like that. Yeah. It just makes it so much more realistic, and totally. You feel that. Yeah.
And it's interesting, you know, like part of the, like, it's funny because I started in film as a kid, and then I went to theater where you like imagine everything.
Yeah.
And then I did a little bit of film. It actually was a film that never came out, but it was a very expensive Czech film, and it was all CGI, so it felt like theater because you had to just imagine everything.
Yeah.
So actually for me it was really comfortable because I'm like, well, I do that anyway all the time. But then doing Man and Witch was like going back to, I mean, a very small scale. We're an independent fantasy film. We're not like a studio film, you know. But we were like in the elements, like you're on a field and there's ice and there's wind and there's cold, and then you're in a castle and those stones sound a certain way and feel a certain way.
Yes.
And those puppets have a human being with a beating heart inside that's responding to you. And so everything is real. So it was just nice to come back to that.
That's beautiful. That's awesome.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
Who's in the film?
Woo-hoo! I still myself. I can't. I don't understand why all these people agreed to do this film with me. Thank you so much. So Christopher Lloyd, he's amazing. And Shoreya Ghoshlu. I don't know if you guys. She's an Oscar winner.
Yes.
She's dance. She's incredible.
She's amazing.
Played my mother in the film, and I want her to be my mother in life. Like, she's amazing. Michael Emerson plays our evil wizard. And then we have
from Lost.
He's from Lost, and a bunch of other things. And then for the puppets, the people voicing them are Sean Astin.
Sam.
Yes. So for me, he's like the perfect best friend. Like, you couldn't ask for like a better best friend than Sean Astin. And so the dog is the narrator and the lead character's best friend. So he was like on our wish list when we had like the mood boards on the wall. We're like, who would take this? And we're like, well, we'll never get him, but like, it has to be Sean Astin, right? And then he agreed and we were like,
wah! Oh, it's so great.
And then, it just kept getting better and better. I can't take it. So we have Eddie Izzard, Jennifer Saunders, Bill Bailey, all like UK royalty talent, comedy talent. Daniel Portman from Game of Thrones. He's hilarious. Stuart Bowman is our king, and he's really funny. And he's going to be on the new Rings of Power, speaking of reboot.
Oh, my God.
He is unbelievable. And then we have some people debuting. So we have Martha West, who's Dominic West's daughter. And she steals the show. That girl is unbelievable. And then we have a dance master in our fantasy world. I'm a dancer. There had to be dance in it.
Gotta have dance.
So Giovanni Pernice is the sort of king of Strictly Come Dancing in the UK. It's like the Strictly, you know, the dance shows that we have here. And so we had him like be our dance master in the fantasy world because he is the UK's dance master. So that was fun too.
That's awesome.
Nice.
All right. Let's see, for NGG.
What is the best way to follow the news about this new film of yours?
best way is to go to manonwitch.com and just to hit the subscribe button. If you want a more in-depth view of what we're doing, my company is called Paper Canoe, and we started out with, I went from dance to plays, to puppet shows. I've always been really into puppets. And then now this is Paper Canoe's foray into film. So we have like a weekly, we open house on our Patreon page and we film like what we're doing. So like this week I'm finishing up the sales trailer and I'm working on the sales deck. And then we're going to give that to our sales agent. And so you kind of get a behind the scenes look at how we're navigating moving an indie fantasy film into the market. And we feel like it's really important to not just pursue, you know, what we're doing, but to kind of share what we're doing so that hopefully other people who are interested in doing these things can learn from our mistakes, learn from our successes. And it does, it just, it really, the support that we get from people makes me on days when I'm like, gosh, I don't really know how to do this. I'm like, nope, I got to do this. I got all these people rooting for us, you know. And then, you know, something happens and something awesome breaks and then you have people to celebrate it with. So I'm really enjoying opening up that process and sharing it with people.
And everything she just mentioned, every link is in the description down below on the YouTube side. So you'll see everything there. So you can click on manonwitch.com and everything Paper Canoe and all that stuff is there. So you guys can, you know, click right there. The Patreon as well. All of it. It's all there. So enjoy that. So that being said, and real quick, you got me hooked on it, so I'm gonna be balling with you. I'm gonna be doing everything I can to just, I'm in love with this. I want to push this and I want to do my part too as well and help out. So I'm really happy with this. So let's see.
DJ, oh, here we go. Now this is one I want to know is, and I'm sure you're excited for this one. What was it like working with Christopher Lloyd? I mean,
it was amazing. It was amazing. That's what it was. I was just like, oh my God, look what is happening to me. It was my favorite day on set. I have to tell you, being in this oasis in LA with Christopher Lloyd and Chirag Dashlu, I was just like, I couldn't stop grinning. I was like, get into character. Yeah. Like, stop smiling. He is such a consummate actor. I mean, the man was literally flying the next day to go be in a play. His schedule is so busy. He like squeezed us in. I was so inspired. How does he, you know, at his age, he has so much energy. He showed up, he blew everyone away. Just pitch perfect, right. You know? And just like so gracious and just never stops working. He just wants to work. He just wants
He's like writing, directing, producing. Yeah. Like he's always on, I've seen his name on everything I watch almost, you know, it's so amazing.
Yeah, he's super inspiring. Like I want to be like that when I'm 80. I want to just be working.
Right?
Right.
Yeah.
That's so great.
Next question. Those who worked on voices for characters for Man and Witch, did you get to meet Sean Astin or others who voiced? Or is it just like, you know, studio?
Yeah. No, I did. My husband was the one that went and met Sean in LA, and he had the best experience with him. And actually, Sean had some really good ideas and little tweaks for the text. And he was so generous and involved. And he said that he was really excited about doing it because for him, it was like he hadn't come across a script that hadn't been through like a subcommittee where like everything's like scrubbed down to the most generic thing possible, you know? And it was like this had like life and personality. So he was really complimentary and really supportive. And he's as nice as you think he is. Like whatever you think he is, as nice as that, and maybe nicer. Like he's great.
That's cool.
So seems right. Him. And then I was in the studio in London with the other voice actors, and that was incredible. It was very technical what they had to do because we shot the puppets on location with puppeteers, and then they had to like fit the lines inside the rhythm of that puppeteer.
Yeah.
And you know, if you think about it, sure, you kind of want to make your own choices, right? You don't want to be like restricted to this. So So it was a very difficult process. And actually, I learned that the Dark Crystal show that they did on television did it that way, too. Everything was.
Oh, that was a great show. Yeah.
And then the actors had to fit it to the voices. So, you know, there's different ways you can do it. But Jennifer Saunders just blew me away. Like, she came in, she was like looking at the goose's beak and it's moving like really fast. And I'm like, this is never going to match. Like, how is this going to work? Right.
That's hard.
She was just like some kind of, she was so funny and it was perfect, like perfectly timed. Like, I was like, wow. How is she getting it just like that? And then she was like, no, I can do it better. And she just did it again. Like, she wanted to get it perfect. Like,
that's cool.
The reason she is who she is because she's that good, you know? Mm-hmm. And then she just cracked up the guys in the sound booth. And you're never supposed to do that. Like, the sound booth's not supposed to laugh in the middle of the recording. Like, so unprofessional. You know, it's a very nice studio.
We take.
And then you could just see her. She just got this like, oh, okay, this is going to be fun. Because she like got them, you know? yeah, they were amazing. Bill Bailey was incredible. Eddie Izzard, I've been a huge fan of hers my whole life. I wish she had a chance to be more improvisational because that's her forte. And this was very like, you know, but she still managed to just change the lines with like tricked us. And then it was even better than the line. And we were like, well, okay. What?
<That's> great.
NGG.
Do you have any upcoming conventions that you're going to preparing for advertisement for your new movie, Man and the Witch?
I do have one con coming up, Comic-Con, May 6th through the 7th in Saratoga, New York. So I'll be there. And right now I'm just super, super focused on getting distribution. So I'm not traveling as much. I'll probably go to Berlin in February. I have a few meetings to take there. So a little bit of travel to the European film market, but mostly right here in this office doing this. All day long.
I mean, it's a day and age for it. A lot of word of the mouth comes from right here on your computer.
That's how you do it. Yeah.
That's how you do it.
Let's see. And JC?
So you were co-producing Man and Witch, written by your husband, Greg Steinbruner, and introducing your daughter, Maya, in the film. How does it feel having your family involved in the film, and how did that come about?
I love it. I absolutely love it. And I've done a total U-turn, which is kind of interesting because when I married my husband, I was like, just so you know, we will never work together. You do your plays, right. I do my dances, and they shall never meet. You know, I didn't want to be like codependent. I wanted my world and his world. And then it was just crazy. I was like, I had my dance company. I was a professor. I had my daughter. I had my sick parents. And like occasionally I would sort of stumble into my husband at 3 a.m. and I'd be like, who are you? Like, I remember you. We were married, right? Like, you're just so busy. Like, life just like, and I was like, this is insane. Like, I married you because I want to spend my time in life with you. And so I just like did a 180 and we paper canoe together, and we were like, we involved our daughter, and you know, we would come up with stories at dinner and she would weigh in on it, and she would open all the shows. Like, she would be that, she was like 4 and she's like, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Silence your cell phones, you know, like tiny creature.
Oh, great.
Missing the show. So she's just been folded into our work from the time she was born. She's always been with us on like set, or you know, I would choreograph with her on like the baby Bjorn, you know, like just here. And she's just like, yeah, that's what you should do, guys, you know. Yeah, it just kind of evolved. And like, and it's we like to make content for families. And so it makes
sense. That's a good thing to be together to do that. Yeah.
Yeah, and you know, it's not, you know, we just I feel like I enjoy things that, you know, 80-year-olds and 2-year-olds can just all chill together and have a good time. And sometimes it makes me sad when, like, I do it. I'm going to be real. Like, I take my screen and she takes her screen and he takes his screen and we're all just in different rooms. And that's nice. Sometimes you need your alone time.
A little alone time.
But, you know, it's also just really wonderful when you can have an experience together. And we want to, we like doing that as a family. We're a movie watching family. That's our fun time. And so we want to make that for other people too.
Nice.
Awesome. Amazing. Is there, I'm sure, like, is there a release date? Not yet, or in the works?
No. I'm working on that. You know, this film was really made in a very unusual way. Typically, a studio will sign on in the brainstorming period, and then they'll insist on, like, well, you're gonna have to use this actor, and then we'll fund it. And then oftentimes you've sold the film even before you've made it. And so the company's like already waiting, you know, they're just waiting for the handoff. This was really done in a very unusual manner. My husband was very much pushing me. He's like, you got to do it, Tammy, bucket list. Got to get back on the screen. I'm going to help you make this happen. Just beautiful. And he wrote this
amazing
script
amazing
for me.
You got a good support system there. That's so great. So great.
It's super romantic.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then, you know, we found an investor who loved it and just was like, I'll give you the money to make this. I believe in it. And that's crazy. That never happens. Like, and then it was like this thing just kept snowballing. And I thought it was going to be a much smaller project. And then it moved to Scotland. And then we were like in the castle where they filmed all the Monty Python stuff. I was like, wow. And it just, and so it's really like an unconventional route. And we don't have, like, I would say typically, like, a film has, you know, however many millions of dollars the film is, and then the marketing budget is equal to that. That is not our film. All the money on screen.
Yes.
And, you know, and now we're just hoping that through, you know, people wanting to, you know, relive a little bit of that nostalgia and who are excited about us being crazy enough to take on a fantasy genre as an independent film, you know, they'll find some light. And, you know, we're definitely getting some really good responses from distributors, and we're trying to work out what's going to be the best deal for us. I mean, ideally, this is the thing that's hard, is we want theatrical, and nobody wants to do that anymore because of the pandemic.
Right.
You know, everyone streams from home, and the business model has really, really shifted. And it's very, very hard to get into theaters unless you're, like, you know, a Marvel movie or something that has an enormous, enormous reach and budget. But we kind of like going around the corner and through the back door and coming up with creative solutions. I mean, it's kind of this whole thing has been a kind of, underdog kind of journey, and we're committed to finding the distribution that this project needs, somebody that understands what it is and is going to push it, you know, bring it out. So I can't give you a release date, but believe me, when I have one, I'll let you know.
Well, we're on a newsletter, everyone. Newsletter and all that, you know, just everything in the description down below at manwish.com. You know what? I wanted to say something. Speaking of romantic, when I saw your husband coming through the doors earlier, I said, wait a moment. I thought to myself, he's the man in The Man and Witch.
He is.
I'm like, oh my Lord. You know, it's like, it's how beautiful. Romantic is that. He wrote it, you know, and he. The Man in Which, this is amazing. It's going to be I know it's a great film, and we all can't wait to get a chance to watch this film and see something more original. And, you know, again, with the puppeteering and all that stuff, it's just
the puppets. I'm so excited about the puppets with the fantasy with all you guys. And it's I'm behind it all the way. That's so great.
I really appreciate it. Thank you for all the great questions and for spending this hour with me and hearing about Man of Witch and letting me reminisce about Neverending Story.
Yeah.
Guys, I want to let's close out. I just realized the timing. Andrew Jeek, final remarks. So let's end, start with you, and then DJ, and then myself, and we'll close out.
I would just like to thank you guys for having me. I thank you so much, Tammy, for answering all our questions for us. And I hope your new movie does so well. I'm looking forward to watching it with my kids and my family.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. DJC?
Hey, it was great talking to you. Great meeting you. And I cannot wait for this. Like, I'm excited. I mean, with you and your husband, you're just amazing people that created something that's just, I think, what every sci-fi fantasy 80s fan would just absolutely love. You got Christopher Lloyd and Jim Henson Creature Shop puppets. I'm in 100%. And dancing. Oh my God. And dancing. So no, 100% behind this, and I cannot wait. I hope everyone checks out the links in the description. I'm going to mention it to my audience when I do my live shows, and this is something I'm looking forward to. So thank you so much, Kronos, for having me on here today to take part in this. So, and thank you, Tammy.
I'm glad to have you guys here. I want to say thank you to Joe Lopez, Veronica Hernandez, Daddy May, Adrian Z, and everyone else who joined in on the chat. First, I just want to finish off by saying thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to talk, you know, get to know you more and get to know more about the Man in Witch film, questions with the Never End Story. You have inspired us since day one, since you were in, you know, when the film came out, was it 84 or so? And you keep inspiring us even now as you're coming to new film. You know, I know it's been a while, but you've done a lot of great things throughout your life, being professor and dancer. And we didn't mention you were also a singer at one point too as well. We don't forget about that. What was that? What was it called? That film, the video.
Fairy Queen.
Oh yeah. I recently saw that. I was like, oh yeah, wait a moment. She was a singer too. So either way, all that you have done to inspire everyone to, you know, to get to this point where now Man in Witch has come. So thank you again for all that you have done for us, and we look forward to, you know, more future news as the days go by, and we'll keep checking the newsletter. I'm going to be on the Patreon next. But other than that, everyone else who's watching, once again, you know, check and download in the description for all the news, all the links, everything from her Twitter to Instagram to manwitch.com, all of it's there. Paper Canoe and all that stuff. So it's just, let's see. Tammy, thank you so much. We appreciate you.
Oh, no, my pleasure. I
really
appreciate you taking
the time to chat with me today. Bye. See you later, guys. And until next time, guys. Later.